Star clusters are large groups of stars. Globular clusters are tightly bound together and can consist of hundreds of millions of stars. Open clusters are more loosely clustered groups of stars, generally containing as little as only a few hundred stars. The Hades is our nearest open star cluster. It is located about 153 light years away from the Sun. It is roughly spherical in shape and consists of hundreds of stars that appear to be of a similar type, age, and composition, and they all have the same proper motion through space. You can observe this cluster by looking up the Taurus constellation, where the brightest star form a V-shape along with the still brighter Alpha Tauri star. Alpha Tauri is actually not part of this cluster, it just sits in the line of sight of the cluster. Astronomers estimate that the age of the Hades cluster is about 625 million years. The core of the cluster has a radius of nearly 9 light years. The stars in this cluster are more enriched in the heavier elements than our Sun and the other stars in our neighborhood. This puts these stars in a different stellar group to our Sun. Their age, metallicity, and proper motions coincide with those of the larger and more distant Beehive cluster, which is situated about 600 light years away from Earth. In a new study, astronomers think an invisible force is tearing apart the Hades cluster. They think that the culprit for this may well be a dark matter substructure. This would contain the mass of 10 million suns, and yet be totally invisible to us. Using the data from ESA's Gaia satellite, they were able to create a new map of the Hades cluster. In this data, they identified a massive bump in this cluster. They believe that the gravitational forces that target the cluster have, over the eons, sculpted two structures known as tidal tails that sweep out in front and behind the central hub of stars. They believe that something is pulling apart one of these tails. Scientists initially produced a simulation of the cluster in order to attempt to predict the current positions and velocities of the stars over time. When they then compared this to the actual data from Gaia, a discrepancy appeared. The trailing tail in the real data had far fewer stars compared to their model. In order to explain this, they postulated a close encounter with a massive galactic lump. The problem was that this would need to be incredibly massive, and yet there was no trace of it. Their solution was to suggest that it was being caused by dark matter, the invisible force that all too often is used to explain phenomena that don't match their models. Let's just take a little step back here. The first question to ponder on is that of the tidal tails. We see these on different scales. Stellar tidal tails are thought to form as a result of the rotation of the star cluster around the galactic center. As the center of the clusters are highly populated, some stars can gain enough velocity to escape the cluster. These escapees will tend to leave via two points, but continue to orbit the cluster. Over time, the cluster becomes more smeared out over these points. It should be noted that we have not actually observed this happening. We only see the various states of these clusters. Do we see these tails elsewhere? Yes, we see many of these examples in galaxies. These are thought to be galaxies that are in the process of merging. As one passes close enough to the other, it disrupts the stars in the outer area and smears them out, creating a tail. But do we know that these galaxies are actually in the process of merging? Well, the short answer is no. It is inferred from what they observe in the still images. Hult and Arp had a very different view of these so-called mergers. His view was that new matter was being created in the center of galaxies and pushed outwards. This could form lumps of gas which might turn into quasars that would continue to move away and would eventually form a companion galaxy. He felt that these so-called mergers were in fact the opposite. A prime example of this is ARP-105. This is considered to be a merger of two galaxies, when in fact the obvious conclusion is that of a protogalaxy being ejected, jet-like, from an active elliptical galaxy. Exactly opposite this is the counterjet, a magnificent straight plume punching through a disrupted spiral. Very close to this ejected galaxy, we also find the telltale signs of a high redshift quasar. When you examine the redshift of most of the companions around this galaxy, they were all positively redshifted with respect to the dominant galaxy. If these companions were falling in or orbiting the dominant galaxy, you would expect to find as many relatively positive as minus velocities. The fact that they were not clearly indicated they were all moving away from the central dominant galaxy. In other words, they had been ejected. Another example that is worth considering is ESO 161 IG24. Here, a galaxy seems to have developed a clustering of material along its arms, possibly showing this ejection process can also follow out along the arms. And this is probably a more classical image showing these tidal arms. So what is the difference between this galaxy and a barred spiral galaxy then? Essentially, they both have arms protruding, one just has longer ones. Astronomers will tell you that the bars form when stellar orbits in a spiral galaxy become unstable and deviate from a circular path. These grow over time and are eventually locked into place, making a bar. In the electric universe, these spiral arms are formed by filaments that twist their way back to the central plasmoid, which powers the galaxy. This will form a loopback much further out. In the case of the tidal arm in this galaxy, are we not just looking at an arm where the filaments in the arm have been pulled much further outwards? Returning to the star cluster, the first obvious point to discuss is the shape of the whole cluster. It is interpreted as a central cluster with two tidal tails. If we examine this structure, you might see something a little different. If we ignore the idea that this was originally a spherical cluster and instead focus on the shape, we see something rather more obvious. The stars are all located within a narrow band that twists towards the center and then flows out on the opposite side. We also know that these stars are of a similar composition and of the same proper motions as the Beehive Cluster. Is it possible these two are connected along a stellar filament? Could the reason we see such a high density of stars around this point be due to the formation of a pinching in this area, leading to an instability in the filament, causing the shape we see, and also the much higher number of stars in this area? The difference between one side and the other would be accounted for by the pinching being less restrictive on one side compared to the other. We know that open clusters are confined to the galactic plane and are almost always found within the spiral arms. This is exactly where we would expect to see filament structures. One other example of an open cluster is the Pleiades, which we have previously speculated sits at the center of the filament we are also part of and passes up through the galactic plane, creating the structure we see called the local chimney. This, we speculated, was created in a massive pinching effect. So the open clusters, therefore, show us an area that has experienced an intense pinching effect, causing the rapid formation of many stars in a very confined area. Could these clusters instead help us to map out some of these larger filament structures running all along the spiral arms of the galaxy?